Good morning, everybody. Yeah, welcome to Peace Evangelical and Reformed Church, and I'm Pastor Mark, and it's a blessing to be able to begin the week with worship. You want to make sure you check your bulletin for the local times and listings of any of the announcements that might affect you the most specifically. And we have some birthdays in the Peace Church family, and I want to introduce to you some of our new members that have joined the church in the last couple of weeks. But first, the birthdays. Courtney Schwalbach has her 21st birthday today. Tomorrow, it's Judy Bloomer's birthday. And also this week, Jesse Dorr, Ken Neushart, Holly Ulp, Stan Diedrich, Don Horswell, and Craig Sharbarth have birthdays. So happy birthday. Also, we took in some new members into the Peace Church family. Some of you are here today. Please stand when I call your name so people will know you and then they can meet you during the passing of the peace. Randy and Ann Lamers, Lois Pruitt, Bill and Mary Stegman, Beverly Ludke, Carol Eckley, and Dan and Amy Johnson. Welcome to the Peace Church family. We love you in the Lord. Thank you. Also, we need to remember in prayer, Barry Roosh, Brenda Van Dalwick's brother, being treated for cancer. He's at West Haven and Brilliant. Also, Lori Neushart and Brenda Zipper. For announcements, the consistory has their meeting today at 10:15 in the pastor's office. Confirmation Wednesday, same time, same place, 6:15 p.m. Also, a note in the bulletin, the sermon is called Making Christ Great Again in Our Lives. And also, we need to remember Lois Pruitt in our prayers. She's going to be having hip surgery this coming Friday, the 18th. Also, please ask Women's Fellowship Group to come to the front of church immediately after the service. So the ladies group for the Christmas Secret Pal meeting right in front of church following the service. We have any other announcements to highlight? Well, then this concludes the morning announcements. Let's look to the Lord in prayer. God, it's wonderful that we can be here to worship you, to get to know you better through Jesus Christ. We ask your anointing and blessing upon our service. In Jesus' name, amen. Greet the person near you and welcome them to Peace Church. Hey, Fuzzy. Oh, very good. Hey, Brian. Hey. Hey, Bob. Good morning. We'll remain standing for the opening songs of the service. Number 4, Majesty, Worship His Majesty. Unto Jesus be all glory, honor, and praise in the songbook and on the screen, followed by We Will Glorify, number 35. Let's worship His Majesty.
Thank you.
That was great singing. We'll remain standing for the reciting of the Apostles' Creed, found in the back of the songbook on the right side and also on the screen. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the one holy universal Christian church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. And we have a special music presentation from the ladies of the Potter's Clay. That was beautiful. Thank you so much. The kids can come up and we'll have the children's message. Wonderful to see you. Good morning, everybody. Hey. Oh, you're so sweet. Thank you so much. Thank you, Lily. I heard a story about a duck that went to Dairy Queen and said, "I want to have an ice cream float." And the person looked at the duck and says, "You don't have any pockets to have money in. How do you expect to pay for this ice cream float?" And the duck said, "Put it on my bill." Get it? Put it on my bill? You get it? Okay. Okay. That's kind of corny. He wanted it on his bill, but what is not corny is that Jesus put on his bill all of our sins. And he went to the cross, and he took all of our sins, and he died for us so that we could be forgiven, so that we can free to love and celebrate God forever. That's how much Jesus loves you, is he took your bill. And I just want you to know that, because the most important thing I can say to you on this day and any other day is that Jesus loves you. This I know. For the Bible tells me so. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you that you took our bill and you paid for our sins on the cross on Good Friday and rose from the dead on Easter Sunday to be our King and our Lord. We surrender all. We give our lives to you because you gave your life for us. Amen. You guys can have one of these delicious treats. Oh, you're welcome. Thanks for coming up. Thank you, Lily. Oh, you're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. You're welcome. Oh, sure thing. I'm glad that you came up. Here you go.
There's my friend Jay.
Oh, really? Tell them I said I'm glad to see them. You're welcome, girls. There you go. Here you go. It's a good thing I got my new Mott's fruit delivery from Amazon.com this week. Very grateful for that. Our Bible reading comes from John chapter 5. The theme of the whole Bible, it's about God's plan to redeem the world through Jesus Christ, resulting in eternal life and transformed life for all who repent, believe, and receive. And the Gospel of John is kind of a microcosm of the whole Bible. According to John, chapter 20, verse 30 and 31, it was written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing you may have life in his name. And the whole book is an evangelistic message to all the people of the world that they may surrender all to Jesus Christ. The seven signs that Jesus does, the turning the water into wine, the healing of the royal official's son, the healing of the paralyzed man we talked about last week, all, and the raising of Lazarus, Christ's own resurrection, all testify that he is equal with God. He is the Son of God and worthy of your worship and your devotion. And yet sometimes we need to hear that message. We need to be reminded of that message. And our text today is Christ reminding and speaking to his Jewish contemporaries about these things. We'll pick up the action in John 5, verse 16. So because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jews persecuted him. Jesus said to them, "My Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working." For this reason, the Jews tried all the harder to kill him. Not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. Jesus gave them this answer: "I tell you the truth, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing, because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all he does. Yes, to your amazement, he will show him even greater things than these. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, that all may honor the Son, even as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life and will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life. I tell you the truth, a time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. For as the Father has life in himself, so he has granted the Son to have life in himself, and he has given him authority to judge, because he is the Son of Man. Do not be amazed at this, for a time is coming when all who are in their graves will hear his voice and come out. Those who have done good will rise to live, those who have done evil will rise to be condemned. By myself I can do nothing, I judge only as I hear, and my judgment is just, for I seek not to please myself, but him who sent me." This is the inspired, authoritative, written word of God. And may the Lord add his blessing on the reading and reflection upon the word of God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for the sacred word of God. And I pray now that the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart would be faithful to the word of God and pleasing to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Years ago, not too long after I first got saved, I attended a GARB Baptist church in Ohio. It was about the size of our congregation, and it had a large nursery. And over the nursery, there was a plaque with a scripture verse, 1 Corinthians 15:51. And over the nursery, this verse said, "I tell you the truth, we will not all sleep, but we shall be changed." Yeah. I always thought that was cute. And yet the truth is that God's plan is to change and transform us, so that we will become more like Jesus Christ. It's God's desire to do that. He doesn't want us to be snippy and snappy and snooty at people. He doesn't want us to be defeated and discouraged by our inability to overcome our demons and addictions. He wants everyone to have a life-altering encounter with Jesus Christ. Like the Jewish people in John 5, we need a fresh revelation of the greatness and majesty and sovereignty of Jesus Christ. We need to be reminded that Jesus Christ is equal with God, so that we will see our sin in light of his holiness and repent of our sin and make Jesus Christ great again in our lives. That's my prayer, that as we hear Christ's testimony to his Jewish contemporaries, that we will be inspired and challenged to make him great and exalted again in our lives. We pick up the action in John chapter 5. In verses 1 through 15, Jesus healed the man who had been paralyzed for 38 years simply by speaking the word. Remember, we pointed out that God created the world in Genesis chapter 1 simply by speaking the word. And here in John 5, Jesus recreated a man's life by speaking the word, thus demonstrating again that he is equal with God. But verse 16 says, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jewish leadership persecuted him. The Sabbath is the Saturday, the seventh day of the week, a day of rest. And the Jews persecuted him because Jesus did not abide by their quote-unquote interpretation of Sabbath legislation. The word persecuted means to be harassed or hurt because of your beliefs. Grant Osborne says the problem with the paralyzed man was that he didn't care who Jesus was. The problem with the Jewish leaders is that they opposed who Jesus was. Picture the scene outside the Jerusalem temple. The leaders approach Jesus with anger and animosity and hatred and hostility. Their eyes are burning with fury. And they approach him, and you can hear somebody say, don't listen to this liar. This man does not keep the Sabbath. And you can hear another person saying, how dare you? How dare you do ministry on a day of rest and sacrilege our religion? But Jesus is calm, cool, and collected. He looks right at the Jewish leaders and in verse 17 declares, my Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. Notice he says, my Father, not our Father. Jesus is going to say later on in John chapter 8, verse 44, your father is the devil. Yeah, he's going to hit that hard. Number one, Jesus is claiming to have a unique father-son relationship with God. John 3:35 says the Father loves the Son and has placed everything in his hands. Number two, by saying my Father rather than our Father, Jesus is insinuating to the Jewish people that in no way, shape, or form could it be said that God is their Father. If God was your Father, you would rejoice that somebody's life has been transformed after 38 years of suffering. You would be celebrating the fact that God is at work in our community again. You would be overjoyed that God has not forgotten his people. The fact that you are antagonistic rather than joyful indicates that you have no relationship with the Father. Now, when Jesus says, my Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working, some people are going to say, wait a minute, doesn't the Bible say that on the seventh day God rested? So how could Jesus say my Father is working to this very day? Well, yes, Genesis 2:3 says that God rested from the work of creation, but he did not rest from the work of caring for his creation. God will never take a day off from loving you. He'll never take a day off from caring about you. He'll never take a vacation from strengthening you and helping you and upholding you with his righteous right hand, Isaiah 41, verse 10. Hebrews 13, 5, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. In the movie Overcomer, a high school girl is running in the state championship. Her biological father cannot attend because he's seriously ill in the hospital. But being a former runner himself, he makes a recording which will guide his daughter through every phase of the race. So when it was time for the state tournament, it seemed like she was all alone, but she was not alone because she had the voice of the Father speaking words of encouragement into her ears through her device, guiding her through every phase of the race. We have that same relationship with our Heavenly Father. There are going to be days when it feels like you are all alone in the world, but you are never all alone in the world because your Heavenly Father is guiding you and speaking to you and encouraging you through every phase of this life, every part of the race of life. He speaks to us through Scripture, and he strengthens and helps us. My Father is always at his work to this very day, in your lives. And Jesus, too, is working. Now, Jewish people believe that God alone is allowed to work on the Sabbath because otherwise the universe, you know, would fall apart. You know, if God stopped caring about us for even one day, we would have no more days after that. We would be history. But Jesus says he too works with the Father. And that has the Jewish people scratching their heads and thinking, who is this guy? How can he say such things about himself? How can he put himself on an equal playing field with Almighty God? That's blasphemous. That's sacrilegious. Leviticus 24, verse 16 says, anyone who speaks such things about himself in relation to God, whoever blasphemes God, should be put to death. And that explains why it says in John 5, verse 18, for this reason the Jewish people sought all the more to kill him. You know what jumps out at me? The expression, all the more. It means their minds were closed from the very beginning. It means that they've been thinking about killing him even before John chapter 5. But they want all the more to kill him because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, according to their interpretation, but he was calling God his own father, making himself equal with God. And now, if Jesus was timid or wishy-washy, he could have said, well, I don't want any trouble, guys. I didn't mean to say that I was equal with God. I just meant to say that I was on God's team, that I'm his partner in ministry. Isn't it funny how easy it is for us to get misunderstand each other and be confused about these things? But Jesus does not backtrack one bit. Instead, he steps forward and gives clear evidences that he really is equal with God, just as they said. In verses 19 and 20, we see that he is equal with God because of his unity with God. In verse 19, Jesus does whatever the Father does. The Father does miracles, so Jesus does miracles. The Father redeems people, so Jesus redeems people. The Father watches over people, so Jesus watches over people. And in verse 20, it says that the Father loves the Son and shows him all that he does. He showed him the universe. He showed him his plan of salvation for the world. And he showed Christ his plan to have Christ reign over the entire earth in the millennial kingdom in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6 and 7, and Jeremiah 23, verses 5 and 6. And verse 20 also says, the Father will show Jesus even greater things than these. Well, what could be greater than that? Verse 21, he shows Jesus that he has the authority to give life. For just as the Father raises the dead and gives them life, so also the Son gives life to whom he is pleased to give it. Now, we don't always feel how powerful this is, but according to the Old Testament, the only person who can raise the dead and give them life is God the Father. And how do I know that? Because Ezekiel 37, verse 13 says, you will know that I am the Lord when I open the graves and I bring you up. And yet in John chapter 5, God shares his ability to give life with his Son, Jesus Christ. And that's why Jesus says the Son gives life to whom he's pleased to give it. Jesus was pleased to offer spiritual life to the most prestigious religious man in Israel in John chapter 3, Nicodemus. And Jesus was also pleased to offer spiritual life to the least prestigious person in Israel, the woman at the well in John chapter 4. And Jesus was pleased to offer physical and spiritual life to the paralyzed man in John chapter 5. And he was pleased to raise Lazarus from the dead in John chapter 11. All these things are further evidences that Jesus Christ is indeed equal with God, the Son of God, God made flesh, and worthy of your love and worship and praise. The Father also gives the Son the authority to judge. Verse 22, moreover, the Father judges no one, but has entrusted all judgment to the Son, Don't you love how ironic that is? The one who is being judged by his religious contemporaries will someday be sitting in judgment over his religious contemporaries. The one who is being judged by the people of the earth will someday sit in judgment over all the people of the earth. The person who is being chastised today will be sitting on his throne and ruling over all those who chastised him in the past. The Bible says that at the name of Jesus, every knee will bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. And according to verse 22, why did God give Jesus Christ the authority to judge? Verse 23, so that all may honor the Son just as they honor the Father. Now, I haven't been to court all that much. Thanks be to God for that. But I have been in court enough to know that when the judge walks in, I'm expected to address that judge as Your Honor. In an even greater way, God wants us to address Jesus Christ as the one we honor, and to give Him honor and praise. And you know, I used to believe, I grew up in the Jewish religion, and I used to think back then that all you had to do was believe in God, and it didn't really matter what religion you were. But I found out I was wrong, because the Bible says you cannot honor God without honoring the Son of God. You cannot honor the Father without honoring the only begotten Son. And how do I know that? Because even in the Old Testament, Psalm 2, verse 12, it says, "Kiss the Son, lest He be angry and you perish in the way, for His anger can flare up in a moment. Blessed are all those who take refuge in Him." Kissing the Son is a Middle Eastern way of kind of saying, kiss the ring or give Him honor. And 1 John chapter 2, verse 22 says, "No one who denies the Son has the Father. He who has the Father has the Son also." And in verse 24, we find out that both the Father and the Son are equal because they both are the givers of eternal life. It says, "I tell you the truth, whoever hears my word and believes Him who sent me has eternal life, and he will not be condemned. He has crossed over from death to life." Notice that the person who hears the word of Christ and believes in God has eternal life. Present tense. It doesn't say he might have eternal life if he happens to remember that this is Pastor Appreciation Month. It doesn't say he will someday have eternal life if he volunteers to sing in the potter's clay and attends every practice. Well, it can't hurt. Doesn't say that, though. It says he has eternal life. If you repent of your sins and trust in Christ and believe Him who sent Christ, you have eternal life right this second. John chapter 10, verse 28, Jesus says, "I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one can snatch them out of my hand. And all the religious things you do and all the good deeds you do are done not out of obligation," because Jesus paid it all to Him we owe. "We do it out of appreciation and adoration for all that He has done for us, and because it is our desire to be more like Jesus Christ." You remember that movie years ago called, I think it was called Be Like Mike? It was about a kid who wanted to be like Michael Jordan, and he was trying his best to imitate Michael Jordan. Well, we should be trying our best to be like Christ, because He saved us, and He is our Lord, He is our King, He is our hero. And when we believe on Christ, we have already crossed over from eternal death to eternal life. And verse 25 says, "The time is coming and has now come when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live." This happens spiritually right now, whoever hears the voice of the Son of God, either in a sermon or in Scripture. John 11:25, Jesus says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. And if you respond to that word of Jesus and say, I do believe, Jesus, I forgive me of my sins and come into my life, then you will be brought to life spiritually right at this moment. But this scripture is also physically true of a guy like Lazarus, because Lazarus was in his grave. John chapter 11, verse 42 and 43, Jesus said, Lazarus, come forth! And he heard the voice of the Son of God, and he lived. And I agree with Dr. D.A. Carson from Trinity Evangelical Divinity School. He says Jesus had to say, Lazarus, come forth, because if he would have said, come forth, everybody would have risen out of their graves and we would have had the final judgment right then and there. So he specifically specifies Lazarus because it wasn't time for the final judgment. Now, having said that, if you look now at verses 26 through 29, we find out that Jesus Christ is not only equal with God in the present time, he is equal with God at the end time for the final judgment. And in verses 26 through 29, we see that some will rise from their graves and they will live, and others will rise to be condemned. You say, well, Pastor Mark, this is confusing to me. How do we reconcile the fact that Christians will be bodily resurrected with other verses that say our spirit goes immediately to be with Christ when we pass away? Well, first of all, I believe we have to affirm all that the Word of God says. So we hold both of these teachings. The Scriptures are clear that the believer goes to be with Christ immediately when they depart this life. Luke, how do I know that? Luke chapter 23, verse 42 and 43. The thief on the cross said, Jesus, remember me when you go into your kingdom. Jesus said, I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise. He didn't say, tomorrow you'll be with me, or in 1,000 years or 2,000 years. He said, today you'll be with me in paradise. And then maybe even a clearer example would be Acts chapter 7, verses 58 and 59, where Stephen is being stoned to death, and he can look up and see God and Jesus at his right hand, and he says, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit. And then he says, Lord, don't hold this sin against him. And he fell asleep. So his body fell asleep, but the Lord Jesus received his spirit. And then when you go to the book of Revelation, there's nobody sleeping in the book of Revelation. They're all praising God and celebrating him and singing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain so to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. But having said that, our spirits are worshiping in heaven, but our bodies are sleeping in the dust of the earth, awaiting to hear the voice of Christ. And when they do, our bodies will rise up, will become a living soul again, just like Adam in Genesis chapter 2. It's kind of a repeat of Adam becoming a living soul when he came up from the dust of the earth. Same thing's going to happen to us. And we will live with God and Christ forever and ever if we believe. If we reject Christ to our dying breath, what does Jesus say? You will rise to be condemned. And then we didn't have time to read it, but verses 31 to 47, you should have witnesses when you're saying something, right? I think Deuteronomy 21, 15, and 17 says a testimony is established by two witnesses. Jesus gives us three witnesses of the fact that he is equal with God. Number one, John the Baptist. John 5, 35 says, you chose for a time to enjoy his light. The second witness is his miracles, the works the Father gave Jesus to do. Verse 36, turning the water into wine, healing the royal official's son, feeding the 5,000, raising the dead. These miracles testify that Jesus Christ is equal with God. And the third witness that Jesus is equal with God are the Scriptures themselves. Jesus says in John 5:39, these are the Scriptures that testify about me, yet you will not come to me to have life. And Jesus says in John 5:46, if you'd have believed Moses, you'd have believed me, because Moses wrote about me in the Bible. Well, you say, okay, Pastor Mark, which Bible verses teach or prove that Jesus Christ is equal with God? Well, Genesis 3:15, Jesus Christ is the seed of the woman that crushes the serpent's head. Exodus chapter 3, Jesus is the angel of the Lord speaking to Moses in the burning bush. Joshua chapter 5, Jesus is the commander of the Lord's army who tells Joshua to take off his sandals because he's standing on holy ground. Psalm 110, Jesus is the Lord at God's right hand. Isaiah chapter 9, verse 6, he is the wonderful counselor, the mighty God, the everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Jeremiah 23, verse 6, he is the Lord, our righteousness. Zechariah 14, verse 3, he is the Lord whose feet will be standing on the Mount of Olives at his second coming. Matthew 1:23, he is Emmanuel, God with us. John chapter 20, verse 28, he is my Lord and my God. Romans 9, verse 5, he is God over all, forever praised, amen. Titus 2:13, he is the great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. 1 John 5, verse 20, he is the true God and eternal life. Revelation 22, verse 13 through 16, he is the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Jesus Christ is great in the Holy Scriptures, and you need to make him great again in your life. And the way you do that is, number one, you repent of the sin in your life that's keeping Christ from being great in your life. Now, I know most of you love Jesus. You wouldn't be here if you didn't love Jesus. But we all have moments or days or weeks or even months or years in our lives where we love our sin more than we love the Savior. We love the flesh more than we love our faith. We love what we want to do more than we love what God would have us to do. And so making Christ great again in your life means repenting of that and making Christ Lord, saying, Lord, please forgive me for not doing this sooner. The second thing you need to do to make Christ great again in your life is to make Christ first in your life, devoting time to reading his word and praying to God each day, making that the most important thing in your day. I recommend reading several chapters out of the Bible a day, maybe start with the Gospels, and read the corresponding commentary, the Enduring Word Commentary by David Guzik on the internet. If you have a Calvary Chapel background, you probably know who David Guzik is. Read those commentary notes in conjunction with your Bible reading, and you'll grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And if you're here today, and you don't know Christ as your Lord and Savior, you feel like you're on the outside looking in, like the Jewish leaders in John chapter 5, it's not too late to get right with God. Look, Jesus stands at the door and knocks, and if there's no knob on the outside, you got to open the door from the inside and let Christ into your life and say, Jesus, I love you. And the reason why you should do that is because he died on the cross for your sins and rose again. And Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells me so. Amen. We'll remain seated. Thank you, guys. And we will sing our song of commitment. Oh, how he loves you and me. If you listen to John MacArthur on the radio at 10 a.m. weekdays, I think that's the song they play as they seeg into his message. Number 254 or 255? One of them. Oh, how he loves you and me.
Thank you.
Amen. Isn't that the truth? Do we have any special prayer requests that we can lift up to God this morning? Yes, Carson. Okay, we will. We'll do that. Beverly.
Pastor Mark, the great grandparents want to get this little boy on as many prayer lists as he can. He's 18 months old. They found a mass in his brain as large as an orange. He's in Children's Hospital in Madison, and the little boy is related to the Eicherts and the Laos in our area.
We'll pray for him. That's so sad. We'll pray for him. Kathy.
A friend of mine, her name is Lori Miller.
Mm-hmm.
She's going to have surgery on November 6th, and they're going to find out if it's cancer or not. She's a little nervous.
Okay, we'll pray for Lori. Do that. Yes, Dale.
My brother is having some medical issues.
Okay, Dennis. Sherry.
Kendall, he had his laser knife surgery, and now it's going to be months before they find out if it did anything.
Okay. We'll pray for Tom, Kendall. Yes, Mary. Yes, Mary Kay. Okay. Okay, we'll do that. Yeah.
I just want to praise God and thank God for you and Jeannie and the ministry you do here. You are truly a blessing to this church family.
Oh, thank you. Oh, you get a hug. Oh, thank you so much. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Do I get to put that in the prayer? All right, just checking. Okay. Yep, Lynn. Okay, and let's look to the Lord in prayer. God, I'm thinking of that scene in, I think it's Revelation 8, verse 5, where the angel brings the bowl of incense before the throne of God, and it represents all the prayers of the saints. And I feel like that's what we're doing now. We got this big bowl of all these prayers, and we're bringing them up to you, God. And I thank you that you're a God who hears prayer and responds to prayer. And we want to pray for Barry Roosh to know the peace and the serenity and the salvation of Jesus as he goes through his battle with cancer. We pray that you give him the healing that's going to bring you the most glory. We pray for Lori Neusheart, that you would bring healing to her and that she would live out her full lifespan. And pray the same for Barry. And we also pray for Brenda Zipperer, that she would feel better as she looks to you for strength. We pray for Lynn Stecker's mom as she takes care of her dad. And we pray that you would give her the physical and the spiritual strength for this wife-to-husband ministry. We also pray for her husband to know the peace of Jesus. We also want to pray for Carson's friend's mom to know the deliverance and salvation of Jesus Christ and victory over addiction. We also pray for Carson's brother that he would find hope and help and health and strength in Christ, that he would be born again by the power of the Holy Spirit, and his wife as well, that they would both be saved. We also pray for the 18-month-old boy with a mass on his brain as large as an orange, being treated in Madison, but has family in this area. We pray, God, that the doctors would do an awesome job of treating him. We pray, Lord, that you would bring healing to him and restore him. And I pray that as he grows up, he'll know the grace of Jesus, but he won't remember what he's going through now. We also pray for Lori Miller as she approaches her surgery date on November 6th to find strength in Christ and courage in the Lord as she faces this procedure. And we pray for good news, too, from the doctors. We also pray for Dennis Hernke to find strength and healing in Christ as he's being treated for some medical concerns. We pray for Tom Kendall, Sherry Geezy's uncle, who's just went through a procedure. It'll be months before we know the final results, and may he patiently put his trust in Christ as he goes through this time. We pray, Lord, for Bill Stegman. We thank you for him and Mary fellowshipping with our church, and I pray for Bill as he goes through the stress test. I pray that the test goes well, that you would be the strength of his heart and his portion forever. We also pray for Victor receiving hospice care and for Wendy Lurkey to know the healing power of God over her life. We pray for President Trump and Governor Evers and our senators and representatives and justices and judges. We pray, Lord, you would give them wisdom so that they could represent wisely. We also pray, Lord, for our troops. We pray that you would watch over them as they watch over us. And most of all, God, we thank you for Jesus, who taught us to pray the Lord's Prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. As the ushers come forward, we'll take up the morning offering. Thank you. Father, thank you for these gifts and help us to use them wisely for your work. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay. Our closing song of the service, God's Not Dead, by the Newsboys. We couldn't get him to be here with us, but we got him on screen.
God's not dead.
Thank you for worshiping God with us today, and I want to leave you with this word of blessing and encouragement. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. God bless you. Have a great day, everybody, and go in peace.